There by the sea that day, Jesus called to fishermen on the beach. "Follow me," he said, "and I will make you fish for people." There in the sparse words of the Gospel of Mark became the first invitation by Jesus to follow. And centuries since, we may still wonder to ourselves, what exactly does it mean to follow Jesus? What does following Jesus ask of me that I'm willing to offer? Or what not? What if Jesus asks me to follow him somewhere that I just don't want to go? These questions are real and raw for us in this year and in every year. I think of the words of writer Debbie Thomas, who's encouraged by Jesus' seaside invitation that day, asking fishermen to fish for people. In other words, she said, if we are going to follow Jesus at all, we are going to have to do it in the highly specific particulars of the lives and communities and cultures and families and vocations in which we find ourselves. We have to trust that God prizes our intellects, our memories, our backgrounds, our educations, and our skills, and that God will multiply and bring to fruition everything we offer up in faith from the daily stuff of our lives. She's so right, because it's there, it's in the daily stuff of our lives. That's precisely where the following happens, right? In the day in, day out, ordinary, extraordinary living, as if the kingdom of God was at hand. That's what God asks of us. What might we say in return? I'm Emily Hull McGee. I'm one of the pastors here at First Baptist Church on 5th in Winston-Salem. And in worship today, we're talking about that holy invitation to follow. I welcome you to our worship here with First Baptist Church on 5th. Let's see where Jesus might lead.
My soul.
The reading from the Psalms this morning is Psalm 62, verses 5 through 8. For God alone my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my deliverance and my honor. My mighty rock, my refuge, is in God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please join us in singing, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah."
Thank you. Mother Teresa said, "If we are to work for world peace, then we must begin with our families." And so on this morning, I invite us to share the peace of Christ with our loved ones, saying, "May the peace of Christ be with you," and a reply, "and also with you."
Old Testament lesson, Jonah 1:1-5:10. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the book of Mark. Hear now these words. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
As we continue in worship, we come together at this time to share these words of confession. Forgiving God, we repent of all the ways we turned from you. You call, but we do not listen. You show us your path, but we prefer our own way. Forgive us, heal us, and lead us back to you, that we might show mercy to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And the good news, as we all know, is that we can be given forgiveness. We can be assured that we are made new in Christ. Join with me in reading together these words of assurance. Hear these words of assurance. If you repent and believe in God's redeeming mercy, your sins are forgiven. Trust in God's promises and begin anew your life with God and all people. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Sometimes you fall, so follow. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours like rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus.
Let us join our hearts and our minds in prayer. The words of the psalmist describe you, O God, as hope, as salvation, and as shelter. Those of us who hear these healing words are invited to put all our confidences in you, to pour out our hearts to you, knowing that you hear us. And God, there is much for us to say. Although we are only a few weeks into this new year, what we have experienced runs the gamut. We've watched the hateful actions of others who infiltrated our nation's capital. We have seen our hospitals filled to the brink yet again as this virus continues to kill thousands upon thousands. We have witnessed a transfer of power and are anxious to see what this means for the deep divisions in our country. We have grieved the loss of church members, of family and of friends, of jobs, and of normal everyday activities. We long to take a step away from the chaos happening in our lives. Yet we know that we too must do the work to make our community and our world a place filled with your love and your justice. When Jesus called his disciples to begin his work of love and justice, he didn't start with the privileged, the wealthy, or the powerful. He began with simple people. He began with fishermen. And for that, God, we are eternally thankful. We pray that his call, "Come, follow me," might again move through our souls today. May we again hear the challenge to be your disciples. May we again hear the message of this one who brings good news. May we again hear the invitation to come to you, all who are weary and heavy laden. May we again hear eternal words of hope, which tell us that however dark the world becomes, the darkness cannot ever overcome the light of the Holy One. May we again hear those simple words, "Come, follow me." And may we come just as we are, experiencing all we have, and know again the depth of your grace and your love for us. Give us the power to bring change and transformation to the peoples of the world, just as those early fishermen did. Give us the power to provide the same kind of hope for the world weary as they brought to theirs. Give us a vision of a world transformed, a world that better reflects your kingdom, as we pray together the prayer Jesus taught those early fishermen. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Herein lies Jesus's first sermon in the Gospel of Mark. It is urgent and immediate. Time's up, he seems to say. The time is fulfilled. Time upon time has come. Kairos time, that's the Greek word, time of the age or God's time. Kairos time has come, as opposed to chronos time or time of the clock, time of the ordinary. The kingdom of God, God's new day, the dawning of what will be, has come. So time's up, Mark seems to say. Pay attention, things are happening. Our words from the Gospel of Mark orient us to the Christ, who then shifts our scene to the beach, where we see a group of fishermen. Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, then James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, they're casting nets into the water. And like a light breaking through the dark horizon, Jesus calls to them, "Follow me," he says, "and I will make you fish for people." Immediately, Mark tells us again, immediately they left their nets, they abandoned their boats, they stepped away from loved ones and livelihoods, and followed him. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, this is one of those scriptures that has frustrated me to no end, particularly in the season of my faith, when all I seemed to have were questions and doubts. My questions were endless. What was it about Simon and Andrew and James and John that made Jesus call to them? And why in the world did they follow? Weren't they bothered by all they were leaving behind? Didn't it scare them not to know where they were going or how they paid their bills or what they would encounter along the way? Did they have any idea what they were getting themselves into? Years later, some of those questions linger for me. But you know, when I think about the times when I seized that Kairos moment, when I took a risk, the times I stepped out in faith, the times I said yes before all my questions had been answered, the times that utterly transformed my life, every single one was a step I took with my whole heart and a radical heap of trust that I was following a path, even one I could not fully see. For me, that was catching hold of a dream and a song, saying yes when Josh asked, "Will you marry me?" Bringing our children into the world, following a call from Kentucky here to Winston-Salem. I wonder about you. When were those times in your life when you risked something big for something good? When you took a step forward in what can only be called faith? What feelings do those memories surface for you? What do you think enabled you to take that risk, to take a step forward, to drop your nets, to seize the immediacy of the moment? Barbara Brown Taylor calls it a miracle on the beach. That's how she describes the story of those first disciples. But the miracle, she says, wasn't the willpower of a group of men or their courage to leave it all behind, their strength to say no to one thing so that they could say yes to another. No, this is not a story about us, she says. This is a story about God and God's ability not only to call us, but to create us as people who are able to follow. If the fishermen did anything in their own power at all, it was that they simply allowed themselves to fall in love. Their minds were not on what they were leaving, but on whom they were joining. Their hearts did not cleave to what was falling from their hands, but what they were reaching out to find. And in that God-drenched moment of their turning to follow, the miracle occurred. For them, their lives flowed in the same direction as God's life. Their wills were not two or three or four, but one. Time was fulfilled. The kingdom came and comes every time our own lives are brought into that same flow so that we too allow ourselves to fall in love and follow God and can do none other. Friends, when we follow Jesus, when we allow ourselves to fall in love, we bring our whole hearts and our full selves into this relationship, a relationship that shapes all the contours and crevices and corners of our lives. Following Jesus makes us alert to those nets that we carry, to the invitations that catch us by surprise, to the fish that cause us to think differently, to the time we have in this world. Time he once called fulfilled. Now, perhaps like you, following Jesus is like Simon and Andrew and James and John. It's immediate and urgent and utterly transformative of the rhythms and practices of your life from top to bottom. Or maybe for you, following asks of you to add or carry or take on, using some of those same elements as before, like the nets and the boat and the water for them. Or perhaps like you, for time or money or family or space. Taking those same elements, but reimagining them in ways that will yield newly abundant life. Perhaps you find yourself like Father Zebedee, unable to imagine a way to fish anew, to leave what you've always known, to let go of the crutches upon which you rely, to try new muscles for the same task. But when you are able to see that miracle of God standing before you in invitation, you follow with your whole heart, with your full self, with your kairos time of the age. And finally, fully, your life flows in God's direction. So here on the precipice of a new year, I ask, what does the call to follow Christ look like in your life? What nets are you to drop? What crosses are you to take up? What might wholehearted following mean for you in what lies ahead? And I ask us as a church, what might it mean for us to listen to God's call? What might a wholehearted following mean for our church as we create and imagine the unknown landscape that lies ahead? On Thursday morning of this week, I gathered with a family and a handful of close friends of Tom Allen. Tom died this week after 88 years of a full and generous life. He was one of our saints, and we remembered his life that day with love and gratitude. Well, as the service drew to a close, I offered space for folks to share any stories or memories of Tom they found to be special. Well, among a few others, we heard a story from a woman who was a lifelong friend of the family. And as she spoke up, she shared with that gathered community that she had recently had a conversation with one of her colleagues at work. She was a teacher at Calvary Day School and was talking with another teacher there. And you see, in the course of their conversation, this friend of Tom Allen's found that her teacher colleague had grown up next door to Tom and Blanche and their four kids, right down in Sherwood Forest. That colleague of hers recalled how much she and her brother loved being neighbors with the Allen family, remembering how they'd play basketball with the Allens there in their driveway and enjoy all sorts of adventures that kids would find in their neighborhoods back in those days. But what this colleague wanted to tell Tom's family friend is about how Tom and Blanche invited her and her brother to come with them here to church, to First Baptist. You see, these neighbors weren't active in a church, and the Allen family loved their church family here at First on Fifth. And so Tom said to them, come and go with us. And there to the neighbor kids, Tom issued an invitation, and they responded. They came time and time again. And in this stirring testimony, this one neighbor kid turned grown woman and teacher at Calvary Day School said, "Tom Allen introduced me to Jesus. If not for their invitation, I wouldn't have become a follower of Christ when I did and started what has become a lifelong journey of faith." I loved the story. I loved it immediately because it reminded me that sometimes following Jesus looks like the fisherman on the beach style, dropping everything and going. But sometimes it means carrying the light of Christ with you on an ordinary day, such that you begin to see and hear and respond in new ways, like Tom and Blanche did. Because following Jesus means stepping into what will be with your whole heart, with your full self, with your time of the age into the time of the ordinary. And finally, fully, your life flows in God's direction. I've told you that story before, the story of wholehearted following. For Abba Lot went to see Abba Joseph there in the monastery and said, "Abba, as much as I am able, I practice a small rule. All the little fasts, some prayer and meditation. I remain quiet. I help as much as possible. I keep my thoughts clean. What else should I do?" Then the old man stood up. He stretched out his hands toward heaven, and then his fingers became like the torches of flame. And he said, "Why not be turned into fire?" Why not? "Follow me," Jesus says. "The kingdom is at hand." Amen.
Please join us in singing our hymn of response, "You Walk Along Our Shoreline." Blessings of this day, let's offer to God these very familiar words of praise.
Thank you.
What a gift it has been to worship God together with each and every one of you this day. If you are someone who has found yourself in our worshiping community and would like to know more about who we are here at First Baptist on Fifth, we would invite you to find out more on our website, firstonfifth.org, where there you can catch a glimpse of who this community of faith is and how we sense God calling us in the world. I do share with delight one in our fellowship who has said, I want to come and be part of this community. We welcome Karen Garman. Karen is coming by transfer of letter, coming to say, I want to be part of this community of faith. And so I say to her what I say to everyone, Karen, we're ready for you to come and lead us to be more faithful and more loving, more just. We rejoice with you this day that you have come to make First Baptist your home. Friends, I want to remind you a few announcements. One is that we will gather for our quarterly church conference. This is the fancy way we talk about a church business meeting, this Wednesday night at 5:30 p.m. You can find out more on our website and find the Zoom link there. I also want to remind you that 2 weeks from today, on February 7, we will be worshiping together by Zoom that morning in a live worship capacity. So mark your calendars and join us at 10:30 on Sunday morning, February 7. I now conclude with words from William Sloan Coffin, words of benediction that mean a great deal to me. So now, friends, as we end this form of worship, to begin again the worship that is our very lives, may God give you the grace to never sell yourself short, grace to risk something big for something good, grace that reminds us that the world is too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.